On three. Listen, man, I'm back. Man, I had to get my water. Got my blunts rolled. I mean, I'm laid up. I got my feet, you know what I mean? Listen. Part three right here. Now, y'all gotta have to buckle up, man. If you on the road, this is perfect. You got a long car ride. You at work, and you could listen to shit at work. You can't get no sleep. You know what I mean? You on your way to work. This is one of them. Now, I'm going to tell y'all, ripping 10. This is going to be a long one. At least an hour. Facts. You know, so we definitely, you got to lock in. I made sure my cat fed. Yeah. Hold on, let me take a hit real quick. This one right here, part three. This might be one of the best ones, I ain't gonna lie to you. You know, while I'm doing these story talks, you know, I was debating, should I like tell them randomly? Sorry, this one gas, y'all. I was debating, should I tell my story randomly? Like, you know, just random different moments of my life, you know, on shuffle mode. Or I was debating, should I just keep these story times kind of in, like, you know, order for the most part, you know, chronological order within my life, you know. But after going over, I feel like for the most part, I'm going to just tell them to y'all, you know, in order, because I feel like At the end of all my stories, y'all be able to connect the dots and figure out who I am. You know, if I just tell them, mixing, like, if I tell you a story from last year, then I go back to when I was 7, then go back to when I was 14, like, I feel like y'all kind of would get confused a little bit. You know, so I feel like it's just easy if y'all could follow me and follow my story if I just tell it to y'all in order, you know. So, and it's a lot of good stories when I got older that I want to tell y'all badly. But it's like, you know what? Let me just wind them up, you know. This story right here, and y'all gotta give me a lot of credit, man, because I'm really going on the fly with these. You know, obviously it's true historical events, so it ain't hard telling the truth. But like coming up with the name and just sitting here locking in, it's a lot to do. This one of these, feel me? Like uploading, should be taking like 2-3 hours to upload to YouTube. I know this one's gonna take forever, so I definitely need y'all niggas to listen and support and fuck with me. But this one we gonna call the Pink Slip. Now, I kind of gave y'all like a little detail on like my childhood a little bit. How it was for me a little bit, but like we gonna get a little deeper, you know. One thing about me, I was born in America, you know, but my family is Haitian. They was born in Haiti. Me and my sister was born out here. My brother and my mom, my dad was born in Haiti. My brother has a separate father than me and my sister. So me and my sister got the same dad. You all got the same mom, but my brother has a different father. Now, growing up, as long as I could remember, I was born in Flatbush. Flatbush is a neighborhood in New York, in Brooklyn. It's a lot of Caribbean culture. You'll find a lot of Jamaicans, a lot of West Indians, things of that nature in Jamaica. It's just a good vibe out there. Just very cultural, you know. I was born out there. I was there for like 2 years, and then I moved to Brownsville. You know what I'm saying? By Saratoga on the 3 train. Now, Brownsville, for those who's not from New York, Brownsville is an infamous neighborhood where, in Brooklyn, it's like one of the neighborhoods that got like the most project buildings. It's a rough neighborhood, but where I was at, I kind of was like on the verge on the other side. So it wasn't really too much project buildings for me, but Brownsville's pretty rough, nonetheless. It's a lot of soul like anywhere else, but it's definitely a lot of violence. But growing up as a kid, I never really experienced things of that nature too much early on. But I knew what was up. Like, even as a kid, as being as young as 8 years old, 9 years old, I was aware that they were Crips in my neighborhood. Like, I was aware of that. My area felt like a baby Cali. Like, because anybody knows in Brownsville, where I was from, the grimy 90s, it is predominantly Crips. It's like Crip territory. For as long as I can remember. So it always felt like baby LA, and it always just felt normal though, because it was just something that I've seen going around. If I'm going to the barbershop, I'm going to get a beef patty, I would see people with blue bandanas out their left pocket. That was a normal thing to see. Or I would see crates and bees around people's necks. I would even see like gray bandanas on the street poles, and I just knew what it was. And me being a kid, I would ask questions like, what is this? What does that mean? And I would get explained and told what it was. Again, keep in mind, I have a sister that's 5, 6 years older than me, and then my brother is like 14 years older than me. So, being the baby of the family, I was always ahead of the curve because I've had people that was able to inform me of things or direct me and steer me in a certain type of way. Like I said, growing up, I just knew my cousins, knew my grandma. We all chilling in the house. Now, again, my brother's 14 years older than me. So if I'm like 5, 6, things that I need, my brother's 19, 20. So he's in his becoming a man stage. Around this time, he's going to parties, clubbing, hanging out. You know what I mean? He got a beeper. You know what I mean? Little shorties and shit. My brother was always fly. He was always that nigga. Braids. He had the Poochie archetype. Like, you know what I mean? Just put out the Yu-Gi-Oh cards. But the Poochie archetype and his sneakers wasn't sketches. You get what I'm saying? So, he was that bull. I even remember around that time he had a girlfriend named Shauna. He's staying over there. Shauna picking me up from school. I'm in like second grade, bro. She's picking me up from school. We going to fucking Woodbury Mall. They buying me American Eagle clothes. At the time, I didn't even know what American Eagle was. I was ahead of the game. Like in second grade, niggas ain't know what American Eagle was. You ain't figured that out till like middle school. You get what I'm saying? So things like that. My brother and Shauna ended up not lasting, but that was a dope relationship, Now, my sister doing things. She's in high school. She's grown. 'Cause like my brother graduated high school. He's working. He's making his own money. He's out parties trying to have fun, and he's still contributing though. He's helping with bills and things like that, and he's buying things for us, me and my sister. So that's initially taking away from the pain and the sacrifice that my parents have to do. Because now if it's my birthday, I remember it was my birthday one time. I came home. My brother bought me the Sega Dreamcast. Bought me a blow up bubble chest, Sega Dreamcast, like 2, 3 games. I was lit. You know what I mean? Like my GameCube, I think my brother bought that. My PS2, my brother gave me. Like my brother, like this is big bro. That's why I'm always have a certain type of admiration for him because he did a lot of things for me. And it's like in this generation now, when I see a lot of older siblings or people in general, they don't do the things that my brother used to do for me. Hand-me-down clothes, all type of things, bro. So, and yeah, he probably bought some of these things for his enjoyment too, because he was living there, me and my sister, but still, it was just, he bought it on my birthday though, or certain things, just like I respect him for that, So you have to understand my mindset now. It's like, this is big bro, like he can't do no wrong. I still love my parents. They treat me good. They're doing everything. Mommy and daddy together. This is all I see. This is all I know. Now, again, let me go into my sister. My sister now, she's in high school now. She's dibbling and dabbling. Smoking a little Black and Milds with her friends. Getting into little fights with this and the third. See, my sister went to South Shore. South Shore is a high school in Canarsie area. You know, that's where Pop Smoke is from. The infamous Pop Smoke. You know, so it was definitely tough back then, back in the days, you know. That era, that school was always a quote-unquote bad school, you know what I mean? My brother graduated from Sheepshead Bay, which is a school that was basically in Coney Island. Those who know. You know, so, my sister dibbling and dabbling, coming home a little late. You know, I remember it was one time where she had her friend pick me up from elementary school, because the drill was after school, my sister would be the one to pick me up and we would go home together. Meanwhile, my brother's at work, my parents are at work, whatever. I remember a situation where my sister made her friend pick me up, like her classmate or whatever, like her high school friend picked me up and dropped me home. My sister was out doing whatever she was doing, the Lord knows what, hanging with her friends, doing whatever she was doing. My sister came home maybe 30 minutes after me. Now, what was so crazy about the situation was, I believe on this particular day, either my mom didn't go to work or she came home early. It was something that happened to where, because my mom was basically a bus matron. So if you don't know what a bus matron is, it's basically someone who is on a bus. You know, they, you know, surveillance the kids. Like, they make sure the kids not getting crazy, out of character, da 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 da. You know, let me rewind a little bit. So, you know, my parents came from Haiti. You know, my mom was brought by her mom, aka my grandma, when she was like 17. But the furthest level of education that my mom achieved out there in Haiti was 8th grade level. It was like equivalent to an 8th grade in out here. So I don't really blame her, but with her coming out here to a whole new lifestyle, having to adjust to the new language, new living, new money, new economics, politics, everything, it's just like she just never further pursued her education. So she didn't always make the best decisions. She didn't have the best job, you know, but at the end of the day, I respect her because she did what she could, you know. So my pops, on the other hand, was a math teacher in Haiti. Same thing, came to New York, you know, it's a new thing, it's a new readjustments that you gotta make. You know, I always try to think, like, what if I picked up my bags and just flew to Brazil and had to learn the new language and had to learn the new, you know, it would be tough. It's not easy to do, you know, so I always tried to keep it in the back of my mind. But my father was a smart guy, you know, he's pretty smart out here. He worked for, like, an electronic company out here. He built, like, ACs and all types of stuff, so he was cool. You know, but my mom was a bus maker, you know, so sometimes, you know, like, if the kids in school, like, she would come home for a lunch break, you know, like 12, 1 o'clock, she might come home. The place where she worked at was in Queens, but you could take the bus there, you know what I'm saying? So, like, it was like one or two buses that would take her there. So now, sometimes she would come home on her lunch break because she would have bad time. Or if it's like a half a day or certain things, like, she probably would have. So it probably was a situation where it was like a half a day that day or something. So now, she home early. She see I come in the crib. I think I had my own keys at the time. She see I come in the crib. She's wondering where my sister at, though. My sister now. So now, again, at the time, I'm probably like 10 years old, bro. I don't even know what lie or what excuse to even make for my sister. I'm like, yo, I don't know. Like, she said she's going to be right back. Like, my mom, hot, like, waiting for her to come home. She's come home 30 minutes later. Now, what made it worse is that my mom was snooping around through things in my sister's room and in our room, because we shared a room at the time. And, my mom found some Black and Milds in her book bag, her North Face book bag. My My sister had two North Face book bags, a big main one, and she had a small little mini one. I don't know if y'all remember, but at that time in that era, a lot of people used to love them little mini North Face book bags. So me, she had one of those. It was in there. My Luke found them. Feel me? I'm such an old nigga. I'm so from that cloth. Like at that time, it like Black and Milds was making flavors. Like it was peach Black and Milds, strawberry Black and Milds. Same thing with like my sister. She had I think she had like the Duchess too. Like I'm not sure. I don't know if she had the Duchess, but I think she had like Duchess in her bag too. You feel me? So not only did you not bring me home, but niggas found this in your bag? Oh yeah, Mom Duke saw her up. Beat her ass with the metal part of the belt, cracking her on her back. Y'all felt bad, gang. Like, oh my. To the point where I'm in the bathroom, I'm helping, I'm putting alcohol on her back and shit, rubbing, putting oil, but fucking, yeah, I'm mad to the shit, like, Vaseline, like, you know what I'm saying? So this is the nature, this is the cloth. It's like, damn, one of us fuck up, we all feel bad and we helping each other though. We gonna help, even if it means the other one might get in trouble too, we gonna help each other though. Now let me flip the scenario around and let me show you how that go. Remember, my brother's a party head. He coming home late, doing this, that, and the third. Mind you, he was really coming home like 1 a.m., 2 a.m., 12 at night. But he's 19, 20 years old. He has his own job and he's contributing to the house. So, in retrospect, so like, all right, let me tell you what was going on. So, what was going on is that my mom would lock the door. And keep in mind, that's not my father's son. So, it's only so much that my father, like, he only has so much say so in the situation as well. So now what my mom would do is she would lock the door. Like we had the regular lock and then we had the lock where like you put the chain on. So I guess if she would wake up like 12 at night, see he not here, put the chain on. You know what I mean? So now it would be a situation where we living in an apartment building. We didn't live in a house. So it would get to the point, we living on the fourth floor. So it would be a situation where my brother would basically have to sleep on the steps instead of next morning or have to figure it out. You know? My sister being who she is, us being how we are, we all is one. My sister would go unlock the chain for him. She would get her ass beat, shit like that, taking the fall for my brother, you feel me? Or she'd probably get yelled at. She probably wouldn't get ass beat. She definitely would get yelled at. Shit like that. You know, mind you, my brother wasn't even get, I don't know if my brother was getting hit at the time. I don't remember. I don't think so. Because I guess she knew he was too old, you know what I mean, to be doing that. It got to the point where she basically put him out. Now, when she put him out, I was in second grade. That shit hurt me, my nigga. Feel me? Because it's like, yo, you're violent. You're putting out big bro. Like, this is the, like, you're doing too much. You feel me? But at the same time, I'm still a kid. So it's like, all I'm thinking about is video games. For real. You know what I'm saying? I've got to go to school and I'm thinking about video games. I'm not really analyzing or assessing the situation for real, like, but I do know what's happening though. Because it's to the point now where it's like, my brother wouldn't even come back in the house. It's like, so this is the thing. So fortunately, what was so beautiful about the situation is, my grandmother was alive at the time. And, my grandmother lived literally, like, from my building, if you would get out the building, you make a sharp right, you walk like one block down. By the end of that next block, my grandma lived there. So it was a beautiful situation because it was like my brother was able to stay with her, you know? That was a baby. She loved my brother, you know? So it was cool. So now what would happen is my brother didn't even want to come back in the house, or I guess he wasn't allowed. I don't know. But it was to the point where he would come and yell for us outside the window. Keep in mind, we're on the fourth floor. And we would give him his mail. Because again, he was an adult. He had mail coming in. So we would grab his mail, put it in a plastic bag, tie it in the bag, open the window, and we would drop it out the window. And we'll be communicating with him throughout the window. I'm so young, I didn't have a cell phone. There would be times when he'll call the house phone, and like I remember at the time, my brother was taking vacations. He was still living his life, doing his thing. You know? So I remember I would be calling him. I would be bothering him, like blowing his phone up, like, "Where you at, bro? Where you at, bro? Now I'm on vacation. Now I'm at work, bro." Like, we used to really chop it up. And I know at the time, like, he probably had loved that shit because, like, I really was like, you know, little bro looking up to big bro. You feel me? Calling big bro. You feel me? As I got older, I stopped doing that. And I'd be thinking, like, damn, like, I probably shouldn't have stopped. Like, we barely text. Like, I still big bro. Like, I still see him all the time. Like, I was with him for his birthday. You know what I mean? We text, we in a group chat, me, him, and my sister. But it's like, I think about how I was when I was younger and like, how I used to want to be so much up under him. You feel me? But, well, there's some things about my brother too. We're going to talk about that later. But so I'm dropping his mail out the window, things of that nature. So now you got to think, big bro just got kicked out. This was a breadwinner. Now he's not here no more. I need y'all to remember that. Everything was fine in life. I got all the video games. Everybody fly in the house. Niggas got Jordans. The lights is always on. Nothing is wrong. I remember we had the blackout around that time. My brother was still living with us. We were on that blackout, that infamous blackout. You know what I mean? Like, I remember that. But he got put out after that. You know what I mean? So that's just to kind of give y'all a time frame of that era. You feel me? Hold on, let me take a hit. Now, it's me, my sister, my mom, and my dad now. Remember my brother got put out in second grade. Cool. Fast forward now. My mom and my dad is having complications. I'm gonna be honest, I never really got the full real story, or I've probably gotten it, but I've confused it over the years and like I don't really remember. I think it was a situation where my father was still legally married in Haiti. He was separated, but technically he was still legally married. Remember, they both left Haiti, they both came to New York, my mom and my dad. My dad was still technically married to someone in Haiti, but it was separated. I guess my mom may find that out till years later while we was in New York. Now, I guess once my mom finds that out, my mom starts moving shady or whatever. I guess she's getting rides home from work and things that I don't know. Not too sure on all of that. But things just start going left. I'm in third grade now. One day I come home. My dad's stuff is put out the house. It's packed up and ready for him to grab it and leave. Now, niggas is wildin'. Now I'm tight. Now I'm crying at bawling my eyes out. Nah, niggas is wildin'. Ooh. Like, I remember vividly, like, in my room, we had a bunk bed. Me and my sister, I had the top bunk, she had the bottom bunk. And then there was a separate bed that was for my brother. Like, all three of us used to share one room, gang. And my mom and my dad shared another room. But we was all kids, it was cool. We vibing, we playing video games, we up late night blasting music, it was lit. Now, once my brother got put out, we just had that bunk bed. Feel me? So now I remember vividly being on the top bunk crying, my eyes watering early morning. I'm not getting out the bed. My sister like, "Yo, it's all right." Da 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 da. Like, I vividly remember that. Now, same thing. My dad wasn't allowed to come back in the house. So now it's a situation where now my dad had to find somewhere to stay. He ended up staying in Queens. Now, remember I said that too for the next story time. Now, my dad literally would come like every other week or every weekend, matter of fact, all the way from Queens to come see us. Because you gotta understand, this is a dude that was living with us every day, he's seeing us every day. He was stripped of that, deprived of that. A lot of fathers don't want to be in their kids' life, bro. They don't want to take care of their kids, none of that. This is a man that was in his kid's life. He wanted to be there. He wasn't cheating when he was in the States. He had a fucked up past that he probably just never exposed. You feel me? And me growing up, I try to realize it from both sides. Like, damn, why didn't you tell my mom? Why didn't you just keep it a stack? Like, how you got walking around looking great? You feel me? So I try to see it from both sides, to be honest. But once I get through the end of the story time, you know, y'all see what I'm saying. But, so my dad would come every weekend to, get to see her, you know? He would give us money, take us to the park, Lincoln Terrace Park, you know, that's by Utica and, Crown Heights. It was a dangerous park. But it was a very big park and a beautiful park, especially at that time too. You know, swings, all type of stuff. You know, so that was the vibe. We would just have to wait every week to see weekend to see dad, as opposed to we used to see the man every day. You know, like, it hurt me when Big Bro got kicked out, but it's like, this Big Bro, like, I'm a, you know what I mean? I'ma still see him. He right down the block. I can go to grandma's house and see him. My pops is like, I don't know where he's at. I don't know where he live. I'm not going to see him at the end of the night. I'm not going to. It's like, it's just a different type of feeling. Like, ain't nothing like your pops getting kicked out the crib, bro. You know what I'm saying? Like, ain't nothing like that. You know what I'm saying? So, now, I just felt torn. It's like, now I'm the man of the house. I'm the only man in here. It's two women in here. I'm the only man in here. Like, what is this? Like, every day I'm just going through it though. I'm holding it in, I'm doing me. Now I kinda gotta fast forward, because now you gotta think, like, you just kicked out two breadwinners. So now my mom and my dad had, they was building like savings accounts and shit like that for my big sister. I'm not sure if they had one for my brother. Oh, I forgot to mention this too. While my brother was living with us, he had a situation where I guess he got hit by a car and he went to therapy. So he ended up winning like a lawsuit or something like that. So my brother had a little bit of chicken too. That's how he was able to like get me all these video games. He was fly. He was working and shit like that too. But he definitely won a lawsuit that helped him. You know what I'm saying? I forgot to mention that. It's not really too much important in the story, but it's just to illustrate how he was able to take care of himself, even after getting put out. You know what I mean? Even though he was still with grandma, but he was still able to take care of himself. You know, so now, my parents were building a savings, like, trust account or whatever you want to call it for my sister. For as long as I can remember. So they were building this account up, putting money in it, building it up. Now, keep in mind, remember I was saying throughout the story, I was like 10 years old and shit like that. My sister is like 6 years older than me. Remember I was saying that. So if my sister was like 16, I'm like 10. Remember I was like, my brother's like 14 years older than me. All right. So if my sister's like 16 going on 17, that means she will be able to access this money as soon as she turns 18. Let's keep that in mind. She probably got like, I don't even remember how much money it was at the time. You probably got like 30K in this account. I'd say 25 the minimum. Like I'd say it was 15K minimum. But I know for a fact it probably was like 15, between 15 and 30. Keep that in mind. Now, and if I keep taking pauses through this story, I apologize. It's because I'm thinking of other story times in between this story, and I don't want to get in too much of those stories till I can save it for us, you know? So I apologize. But, so keep in mind, my sister can access this money when she's 18. So now, you kick two breadwinners out. So now, for that year, it was tough. Like, we're eating bread and honey. Like, I remember it was a few times where like we didn't have cable for like a week or two, or like it was like we were scraping to get by. Like, we eating oodles and noodles for the week. Like, I remember the feeling. You know, so My sister's scrambling, figuring out what she's gonna try to cook for us to eat, you know, so things of that nature. It was a situation now where it's like we're falling behind now because it's like my mom's probably making like 300 a week. She's a bus matron. It ain't like she work at fucking Apple. She's a bus. No disrespect. You know what I'm saying? So it's like she making like three, and it's then you got to think this is at that time. Like this is not 2024. You feel me? So making like 300 a week. You know, that's cool if you by yourself and you take care of yourself. But when you got two big ass kids, it's like, and you got rent to pay, light bill, what you gotta pay to go to work, you gotta eat. You really didn't have it at all. And she really didn't think that through when she was doing what she was doing. And again, like looking at her perspective, like you shouldn't stay with nobody that you feel like that the relationship is unhealthy. But at the same time, you kicked your son out and like you just didn't think this through. You know what I mean? So now we're falling behind on rent. It gets to the point where we start getting eviction notices and shit like that. Niggas start trying to take us to court and shit like that. So guess what starts to happen? Because now it's like, remember, like for that first year, she said getting through, we scraping by. Now we're pouring into the second year and we're falling behind now. Like now it's just too much. You know, every year they raise your rent, all type of shit now. We in high school, you gotta buy a school uniform, you gotta buy a school clothes, you gotta help us buy da, 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 da. Like, yeah, the men were still contributing, but it's like they got their own struggles to worry about too now. You just divided everybody's struggle when it was just one little struggle. You get what I'm saying? So now, fast forward, niggas start getting them eviction notices. So now, my sister 18 now. Now my sister going to court with my mom. She going into accounts, backing out the breach. 5K here. Feel me? 7K here. I ain't gonna hold you. Within them, once my sister turned 18, within them like 2 years or within that year or whatever, like we got hit with the eviction notice like two, three times. So it was like two, three separate occasions where my sister had to go and grab bread out her account, man. Mind you, it was a feeling of like, well, this was never really my money, so if I'm gonna use it for a greater good, fuck it. But at the same time, it was also a feeling of it's not fair that this is my money though, and I have to waste it all on this when I could be doing other shit. Cause like at the time, she was splurging too, like she was buying clothes, sneakers, getting tatted. She was living her life. She in high school, gang. Like, she buying me shit. You feel me? So it's like, she trying to enjoy her money too, gang. But it's like, every time she look up, she got to pull out bands to keep a roof over. Like, she got to be mommy and type shit. Like, put on the mommy role. Because you got to think, at the time, she also cooking for me when my mom is at work. She doing a lot of shit, gang. Cleaning. So it's like, she had to put on her big girl pants at such an early age, gang. We all did. You feel me? And it's all big boy pants, big girl pants, like, and it was fucked up. You feel me? So that started happening to the point where the money dried up. It was nothing left, bro. It's nothing left. So now we officially lose the spot. It's 55 West. No, it was my fault. It was 416 Rockaway Parkway. Between Wilmore and Lenox. Right by the 3 train on Saratoga. We've been living there for 12, 14 years, my nigga. And we officially was evicted. Now, I kind of forgot to mention this part. Remember, so like, cause now in the last story time, remember I told you I was meeting friends, we playing Yu-Gi-Oh, shit like that. Like, throughout them years, I was living there in that building, that apartment. But now, again, remember, like, years is going by now, My sister was paying it off the first couple of years. So now when we officially get evicted now, I done graduated middle school already. I'm in my first year of high school now. We officially got evicted when I was in the middle of my freshman year. Now, I'm gonna explain to you what it was like. First of all, we already knew because it's like when you go on the court and things of that nature, they're telling you, yo, you got, once they put that pink slip on your door, you come home from school, you come home from work and you see that. First of all, that shit is mad embarrassing, bro. Because everybody in the building is walking upstairs in their apartment and they seeing that. You feel me? You gotta leave, like, then they telling you, yo, you gotta go to court, you got 2 weeks, you go to court, they telling you, you got 2 weeks, package it up, da, 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 like. The day came, them niggas came, bro. They had the U.S. Marshals, man. I think with the U.S. Marshals, it was somebody, bro. Like 4 or 5 niggas deep. Niggas look like detectives. Like, they at your door and they waiting for you to unpack your shit. They wasn't rushing us. They wasn't getting crazy with us because they felt bad looking back in retrospect. They see I'm a little ass kid, all this shit going, like, niggas felt bad. They fake was helping us too, type shit, you feel me? But it's like, they had to do their job though too, you feel me? It's like, shit fucked up, gang. Picture you and your freshman year of high school, bro. And you watching people shut the door on you and you, all your shit. Like, you ain't even take all your shit for real, like, they close, you got your little garbage bag full of shit. Like, we all got black garbage bags full of shit, gang. We sitting in the hallway looking dumb. We don't know what to do, where to go, like. We ain't had no U-Haul, no nothing. We had to call, like, 2, 3 cabs just to take, you know where we went? To my own house in East New York. I mean, stayed there for like 2 months. I'm lying, probably stayed there for like probably like 4 or 5 months. We ended up leaving. I tell you why. Family could be worse than friends, bro. Family could be the worst thing. Family could be worse than enemies, bro. This aunt that we were staying with is like the cheapest person on earth. Now, mind you, this woman, like, at the time, she was getting Section 8, which means that's like housing support, where basically, if you're not from New York, it's housing support, where basically it's a voucher, where basically, you know, if your rent is like $1,300 or $1,100, you actually only have to pay like $600 or something like that. It just chops your rent down a great portion. She was on Section 8. She was working home health aid. She was getting EBT. And we fake had our own money. We wasn't asking her for no money, for real, for real. But she would do shady things while we was over there. Like, if my phone is charging in the wall, she would come home and unplug my shit in my face. We watching TV, me and my cousin. She had 2 daughters. Me and my cousins, my sister, we watching TV, bro. She would come grab the remote and turn that shit off. She go do grocery shopping. She got juice, soda, whatever. Bro, she hiding soda under her bed. The shit mad hot sitting under her bed, bro. Just so we don't get none. And you gotta think, like, again, I'm like 13. My sister like 17. We looking at like 7, like 17, 19, 20. We looking at you like you fucked up, man. That's how you treat your niece and nephew. Mind you, like a year, 2 years prior to that, when we still had our apartment, her kids were staying with us because she had to do back surgery. And while her kids were staying with us, aka my cousins, we was playing video games with them, letting them charge their phone, letting them use their iPhone. We was taking them out, teaching them shit. We was buying them beef patties, all type of food. Like, anything we had, they could have it. But now we over there at y'all place, and you acting funny like we wasn't taking care of your kids, though. The type of shit that was going on. So, you know, after our little 4 or 5 months of being there, we left. Like, we tired of that. My mom ended up taking me. Now, this way the story is powerful. For those of you who really been paying attention to the story times, guess where is the next location my mom took us? I want to take a poll. I just want to let y'all think about this. The next place that my mom took us to was Mary House. Now, if you remember from the last story time, Mary is the mother of Peter. Peter was the dude that would just play the video games by himself. He wouldn't let nobody play unless if we all at his house. Then he would play with all of us. But like, if it's one of us at his crib, nigga, he just gonna play his game and do him. So, Peter had moved from the building he was originally at, where I met him at. Where I met all these dudes at, Peter had moved to East New York. The area called Bamless in East New York. So Peter was no longer living with Poochie, Terrell, Tony, like, he moved away. So a lot of them guys didn't really link up with Peter anymore because he was far away. You know what I mean? Not far away, but he moved away. You know, so the connection was still there, but it wasn't like how it was. So now that my mom wants to stay with Mary, it's like, it's kind of cool, but it's like, this ain't really the nigga to be staying with though, because he's a selfish kind of nigga type of, like, he's a selfish type of archetype. You know what I mean? Like, he ain't gonna offer you no food or offer, like, that's the type of nigga he is. Like, if you in the street and you fighting, he gonna help you and protect you. He gonna fight with you, but like, he ain't gonna share nothing with you. Like, and there's a lot of people that's like that. Where it's like, damn, I fuck with you because like, if I knew I was down bad, you would help me. But like, you just ain't gonna look out off of the love though. You know what I mean? So staying over there, and I started to realize that more and more as I was staying over there. You know, so it became a thing where I was trying to even stay out the way. Like, a lot of times, like, that summer or that time that I was there, I lost a lot of weight because a lot of times I was going to the nearest parks, playing basketball, meeting dudes in the neighborhood. Sidebar, a lot of them dudes that I met in that neighborhood was some real steppers. Like, I'm talking about they in jail right now facing bodies. You feel me? So that just go to show you the environment that we was at, that I was growing up in, you feel me, or just, you know? And, this is one dude in particular, like, when I was staying at Peter Crib, like, we used to play ball all the time. I used to see him in the whole time, say whatever, like, we used to stand in front of the building, like, he lived in Peter building, I used to stand in front of the building with him, and it's like, this dude is in jail right now, fighting, like, 2-3 bodies, like, 2-3 attempts, like, you know, so it's just so crazy. And I know his little brother. His little brother be trying to rap now. You know, so life is crazy. But anyway, yeah, so at the time, I was playing a lot of basketball, working out, you know, things of that nature. Just clear my head because it's like, I'm not happy with my situation, you know? I remember I had a little Xbox. And this how fucked up niggas was. I remember they put a note on the bathroom that said some shit like, please clean up after yourself in the bathroom or some shit like that. Mind you, like, I think they said that because my sister was combing her hair and, like, it was a little bit of hair on the sink or whatever. And mind you, I get it. Like, it's not our crib, so niggas could feel a way about that. Again, it's not our crib. Niggas could feel a way about however they want. But at the same time, let me ask y'all a question. Again, we not entitled to nothing. But if we're going to talk about cleanliness, let's talk about cleanliness. Them niggas will have their turtle living in the tub, gang. So now they turtle will be shitting all day in the tub, sitting in water. They like, you got your turtle living in its own doodle, basically. So now, anytime we wanted to take a shower, like, we had to lift up that dirty-ass turtle out the tub, Take a let all that dirty water come. Like, come on, they tub was mad stains in it, all type of shit. Like, niggas didn't even feel comfortable being there. Like, that's the thing. Like they making it seem like they had a 5-star mansion. Like, gang, we don't want to be here. We're here by choice, unfortunately, nigga. But my mom dragged me here, nigga. Like, you know what I'm saying? So me and my sister fake feeling away. Like, yo, bro, like this is not even the best place to be. Like, what? It's the more funny shit that niggas was doing. I remember I had my game plugged up and I'm playing my game, right? And the nigga, he had an Ethernet cable, so he would plug his Ethernet cable in his game, right? I had my Xbox. I asked him, like, yo, I could plug the wire in my Xbox, bro. Because I don't remember if the Xbox 360 was wireless. I think it had to be. I don't remember. I was like, I could plug the wire in my game. He's like, yeah. He was wireless. Yo, one day I came home. Yo, bro, I was no longer able to access the wire. Like, he hid the wire. Like, he moved it somewhere. Like, he put it in his room and, like, just, I never was able to access it, bro. At one point, I think it did have wireless to it at 360. At one point, I think was trying to fuck with it on the wireless type shit. I think I even had the P3 or some shit. I'll try to fuck with the PS3 wireless type shit. Cause I had both. I had the PS3 and the 360. So I think I was trying to fuck with my PS3 on some wireless shit. I put in the password that I knew cause he gave me the password before. I put in the password. Yo, the nigga switched the password, gang. So not only did you take away the wire, so I can't even play my Xbox for real, for real. But because I have better games on Xbox, but then you changed the password so niggas can't even go wireless on the P5. Like, and the way his archetype was, if you ask him for the password, he gonna give you attitude or like he gonna like I just knew him. It was just to the point where you didn't even want to ask. Like, so I'm just like, wow, that was it for me. I was like, damn, that was like, I can't like it, that. I ain't gonna hold it like that shit really hurt me, bro. Like, I ain't crying nothing like that, but it hurt me because it was like, damn, bro, like, I respected it though. Like, I ain't tripped none of that because I'm like, yo, at the end of the day, we are inconvenience to them. Like, he didn't wake up and ask for this. Like, he ain't wake up to ask for like me, my sister, my mom to be here. That's awkward, gang. Like, you probably can't be as comfortable as you want to be. And I get that, all of that. You feel me? But like, we always stay in him and his mom room. Like, we were staying in his mom room, and I think my sister was staying in the living room. Like, we were sleeping on sleeping bags on the floor and shit like that. Like, real shit, gang. You know, so we not in your room like that. We not, you feel me? And again, their house is not even that clean. Niggas got mad shoes in the living room. Niggas sleeping on the floor next to shoes. Niggas sleeping next to fucking bike pedals and shit. Old ass 2000 big hunchback computers and shit. Like, nigga had some big doofy ass off-white fat back computers and like, come on, bro. Like, you feel me? But we had to make do what we had to do. And it's like, one thing about me, I'm forever grateful. I don't ever want to make it seem like I'm talking shit about a nigga that did something for a nigga. But at the same time, we all gonna speak the reality. I'm grateful for his mom. Cause I know his mom was the one that was willing to extend that. If it was up to him, bro, that nigga would have never let us even come in for a cup of water, bro. You know? So once I realized that and once I started understanding that, I was like, damn, this nigga really not my mans for real. Like, I was just around, but I wasn't really this nigga mans for real. You know what I'm saying? He came to my crib one time. Remember all them years we used to go to Peter crib. He came to my crib probably one time. Nigga never came back after that. We was playing video game. Nigga, and my crib looked better than his at the time when I had my crib. So it was like he never came back, you know. So it was like, you know, a lot of things are starting to register now. Like, damn, Peter never really was my mans like that. Like, you feel me? So now, same thing. We all start feeling uncomfortable. We end up leaving them. Now we getting into the shelter. Feel me? Now, the first shelter, I damn near remember all the shelters, damn near almost. Like, if I don't remember the address off of heart, like, if, like, I could probably look it up and find it. Like, the first one we stayed in was I think it was 15 Blake instead of Avenue. It sounded like that. Right there by the L train. And let me bring it back. So first of all, you gotta go to this place in the Bronx called Pat. Now, Path basically, is like the headquarters for the cell phone. So like when you get there, bad families, they got the strollers, book bag lean to the side, they hoodie, got they belly poking out, they got dirty leggings on, holes in their leggings. Fucking shoes is leaning. All these type of niggas. You got some niggas on the line that's fly. Like, their house probably burnt down. They probably got into a divorce. Like, not everybody on the line is bummy. Not everybody that's homeless ain't bummy. Some people got different situations, you feel me? So, that's one thing that, like, me being homeless myself taught me to understand, you know? Because it's like, if I was never homeless, I would have mad homeless jokes. Like, yo, like, you know, but me going through the situations I went through in life really made me more open-minded and want to promote awareness, actually, you know what I mean? But yeah, everybody on the line, long-ass line. Now, when you get in, mass security guards, it's like 3-4 metal detectors. Now, when you get past the metal detectors, it's another line. They got like the little ropes that you wrap around and you walk in between the ropes and to keep the line organized, right? Then they got like 4 people at the front desk with computers. When you get to the computer, keep in mind, the whole scanner process, like everybody walking through the scanner, everybody, that should take like 30 minutes to an hour. Cause niggas is mad slow. You gotta think like, everybody is homeless. Everybody is coming here with all of their items, or at least as much as they can come with. They really tell you you're supposed to only come with 2 bags. Some niggas be coming with mad shit, bro. You know what I'm saying? So, you gotta think about all of that. And boom. When you get to the fucking counter, now they wanna know what you ate for breakfast. What's your favorite color? They want to know what socks is on your feet, what name brand. They asking you everything under the fucking sun, my nigga. And they asking you they asking everybody, like, in the family. Me, my sister, my mom, like, yo, what's your social? Yo, what's your name? What's your birthday? Yo, what's your address? Yo, where did you live? How long was you living in? Yo, is there nobody else you can stay with? Where you from? You never live nowhere else in this? Like, they asking you all of that, gang. Now, if they come to the conclusion that you have someone to stay with, or you make enough money, or they can deadass deny you. In the beginning, when we first were homeless, I feel like they was taking everybody. But over time, they started denying them. So when you see a lot of people that's on the street, and they looking like crackheads, and they don't got nothing to eat, and a lot of people are like, yo, they need to go to a shelter. My nigga, you can have nothing. You can have no crib, and you could go to the shelter, and they can still find a way to deny you, bro. So, a lot of times, that's why niggas in life in this world need to be humble. And when you see someone who's a crackhead or who is just living on the street, like, just think twice and don't always assume. You feel me? But so yeah, we ended up getting. I guess they put us through now. I don't even want to say they accept us, but they accept the information. They put us onto the next floor. This building probably got like 8 floors. So it's like every floor is a different process. So you go to the second floor, or you go to the third floor, and it's like, it's this. You got to talk to this person. Then you got to talk to this person. Then you got to explain this. Then you got to explain that. Like, they're just taking my information, what school I go to, because all of this is going to factor into where they're going to put you. Like, if you work, like if my mom work and my sister work and I go to school, and I live in Brooklyn, they're going to try their hardest to put me, you know what I mean? But now, if it don't work, then they're going to have to put you somewhere else. And it's like, you know, they got to match you with a case manager when you do get to the shelter. It's a lot of shit that they doing behind the scenes. You know, so Here's how crazy it is. You could get to this building at maybe like, if you get there anytime after 2 p.m., 9 times out of 10, your process will not be done that day. You will literally be there all day. Then by 10 p.m., what they start doing is they have mad yellow school buses lined outside, mad cheese buses. We call those the cheese bus. They have mad of them just lined outside. Now everybody got to get in them shits with their kids, with their stroller, with whatever they got, and they're gonna drive. Now this the they'll drive you to a motel. It'll be like 10 a.m., 11. I mean, it'll be like 10 p.m., 11 p.m., and they'll drive you to a motel because these because again, the building that you at, these people gotta go home. They gotta clock out. They gotta come back and do tomorrow the next day. So every all of us that's homeless, we gotta get in this bus. They're gonna drive you to a motel. It's the nearest motel. It ain't the 5-star. Like they dropping different people at different motels, different buses. So this person might go to this motel. This person might go to this motel. But for the most part, they drop most people. They have like a designated motel, I guess. Like they partner with them or some shit. You know. Now when they drop you to the motel, you gotta rush, get to sleep, whatever. Now you gotta think. You gotta think of the feeling though. It's like you're on the bus. It's late night. You tired. You've been up all day in this building. You hungry. You on the bus. You going to this motel. The motel not even that fire. Not even that elite. It probably got a little TV, so you probably a little excited. You can watch a little TV, but it's like you can't even watch it for real because the bus is gonna. If they drop you off at 12 at night, the bus is gonna come at 6:30, 7 to pick you up. So now you got to be up by like 5:30. So you can't even really watch TV for real. Really, you know what I mean? So you just there to sleep. You wake up. You back on that bus. They bring you right back to that building. If you're lucky, you'll be out of there by 1 p.m. the next day. When they bring you know what I mean? When they bring you back that day, the next day, like you'll be lucky if you make it out at 1 p.m. You might fuck around and still have to get out at like 5 p.m., 6 p.m. You get what I'm saying? So now, by the time you get out, they're gonna ask you, "Yo, you need a Metro card, or you want to wait for a bus, and the bus will drop you to your official shelter now." Sometimes we used to go. Sometimes we waited for the bus. I think the first time we waited for the bus, but man, so now got to the shelter. 50, the 515 Blake or whatever. I think that's what it's 515 Blake. But you feel me? So once we got there now, it was just a vibe, like it was a feeling like, damn, this is it. I'm here with my faces and my mom. Like, as soon as we walk in, you gotta take this binder that they got. It's two security guards. They're sitting down behind a bulletproof glass. They hand you this binder. They give you a pen. You gotta sign your name. Every time you come in and out this facility, whether you're going to the deli, you're going to the corner store, you're going to the, they don't give a fuck. You can be running to the car to give somebody $5 and come back. Every time you come in and out this facility, you have to sign your name in the book. You have to date it, and you have to put the time you left and the time you came back, and they gotta review it. Again, I am in the middle of my 9th grade year in high school. This is Freshman Friday. Like, this is like, yo, like, high school is supposed to be the beginning of the new, like, the beginning of a new. It's like, but I got this fucking black cloud over me. So, the hype, excited, jittery feeling that everyone else is getting from, I'm not fully experiencing that because when I leave, I'm experiencing some new shit that I've never experienced. I'm walking in a shelter. Mad grown ass men live here. They look like gang members and shit. Niggas look less fortunate and shit. They kids look like they starving, running around, making mad noise. The way that I can explain the setup, it looked like Baby Boy. Like, remember when Jody was like, how that crib was like when Jody was staying with Yvette or whatever, and then when Snoop Dogg came and took over, like, You see how it was like balconies? Like how he had to walk up the steps and it was like balconies and like mad apartment doors lined up back to back to back to back to back, side by side by side by side. That's exactly how the shelter looked. But picture that times three. Like everywhere you look, it's apartment doors. They call it a unit. So it's like niggas just lined up living side by side by side in them little ass apartments, gang. But it was like four floors and that shit rotated around like the whole, you know what I mean? But it was a big ass playground in the middle though for the little kids. You know, so it's like you could be on the balcony looking at everybody, like anybody could be looking at you. Like somebody could be watching you walking in, somebody could be watching you leaving. I didn't like that feeling. You know what I mean? And we're in the hood. You know, so it's like you don't know who out here, like, cause you'll see certain people, like, it was gates too. It was like see-through gates. And you would see people like by the gate talking to other people outside the gate. Like, you don't know who handing who a gun, who handing, like, that's the type of vibe. Like, and, like, if you had beef with a nigga in there, a nigga, there wasn't no metal detector, so anybody could have came in with anything regardless. But it's like, let's say if you had beef with someone in there, somebody could be walking by on the outside gate, slip them something, and they come get you up out of it. Like, that's the type of, I just didn't like it. You know? But I got used to it. I adapted to my situation. I adapted, like, ninth grade. My high school is basically in Red Hook. You know what I mean? Blood niggas over there. You know, so now I'm kind of, and remember, I never was no bitch. If you remember from my last story times, like, I ain't taking none. That oppression, like, I ain't dealing with it. For me, so, and I know at the end of the day, I could still call my big brother and he's gonna still pull up and, I mean? So it's like, I'm still doing what I want to do at the end of the day. I'm still carrying it. You know, so it gets to the point now, you know, we got case managers, housing specialists. You know, these are people that you got to speak to and see on a weekly basis. They want to make sure that you're saving, you're looking for housing, you're doing, it's a whole process, man. You got people on your back for real. You know, we had to do all of that. Same thing. Remember how I told you when my pops got kicked out, how he was coming every week to come see us? Same thing. We in the shelter. He coming every weekend, giving us money, buying food for us. He trying to take us out to go on the bus to go over here. He just was trying to take us around to just clear our mind. And I respect him so much for that. You know what I'm saying? Like doing shit like that. You know, at the time it felt like it hurt him more than it hurt us, you know? Like you can see the pain in his eyes and shit like that. Like he don't want his kids going through that. And you gotta think it was painful because it's like, yo, like all of that could have been avoided, you know, like two breadwinners was kicked out the crib. Everything was good before then, you feel me? And it's like now look at us. We all struggling and it ain't even had to be like that. Mind you, I forgot to mention, throughout the years my grandma had passed away. So now my brother had to bounce around from girlfriend to girlfriend, finding different places to live, moving in with this girl, doing things with it, you know? And it's just like, it was just a weird situation that none of us ever had to be in for real, you know? But could I be wrong for my mother trying to take a stand and trying to create discipline? I can't be mad at you for that, but I could be mad at you for like not thinking things through and planning your next move and your situation and how what you do is gonna affect everybody though. You know? But yeah, you know, the thing with being in the shelter is like every location you're at, they tell you the maximum time you can be at that location is 6 months. Some of them, if they feel like you're getting far, if you feel like you do, you're making progression, they'll let you rock out. Like we've been in places for like 2 years. But then there's some locations that's very fucking strict. You don't sign your name in that book, or you don't do this, or you don't do that. You don't go meet with your housing specialist, them niggas will get you the fuck up out of there. We've been in shelters for 2 months. All in all, I was homeless for 6 years. From when I was 14 up until when I was 20 going on 21. basically from the year I became a teenager, damn near, to the time I was old enough to drink. Two different life, you know what I mean? Life points, like two different monumental points, moments in your life, like that big of a gap. High school is 4 years. I was homeless longer than someone would be in high school. I didn't have a place to call home longer than you being in high school. A lot of people be in college for 4 years. I was homeless longer than that motherfucker being in college. So, I'm not like none of you niggas. Respectfully. The shoes that I've walked through, the things that I've seen, like, I'm really a 101, like, and it's not to brag or to make it seem like I'm better than somebody, nah, it's just my story is a 101. I cannot be duplicated. I cannot tell you how to do what I do or how I think, because it's just like, you would have to have been through what I've been through, for real, you know? We got out that shelter. We was in another shelter a couple blocks down, 21 Juniors. You could look that up. Same thing. You got to write in and out. I like that spot a little better. It was a little more clean, a little more doper. But I feel like, you know, I think it was a little smaller than the first spot, though. I don't know. But I like that spot a lot, though. It was dope. It was a lot of memories. Playing ball with hood niggas over there. That's when I started to meet a couple wolves. You know, if y'all familiar with the Wolves and the Chos, Wave Gang, Hood Stars, that's when I started to become familiar with a lot of those guys, when I was in that shelter. Cause I used to go to the park and I used to play ball, and some of those faces I remember from when I was a kid, I'd be seeing them in these music videos now, and it's like, you know, I don't agree with everything that everybody's doing, but I'm just glad to see that certain people still alive and smiling, you know, having a good time. They breathing, you know. But yeah, man, they would violate though. Like, they would even put us in shelters in Queens. I remember I was in a shelter in the Queens. I remember I was in shelters in the Bronx, traveling mad fucking far, still going to the same high school. I'm a loyal guy. Like, I'm not switching my school. I still fuck with my bros. I gotta still come here. So I'm living in shelters in Queens, living in shelters in the Bronx, but still traveling all the way to Brooklyn to go to high school, all the way to Red Hook. You know what I'm saying? So it was tough, you know, avoiding fights, shootouts, probably about to get robbed here, like missing trains, running late for school, doing like being mad, tired, sweaty, playing basketball after school, but then you got to take the train for like 2 hours. Like, I went through it all, man. I definitely went through it all. Like, it's so fucked up, too. Like, it was this one shelter because now my birthday is in August. So, I don't turn 18 till August. So, that's in the summertime. It's so fucked up. I remember I was in my last year of high school or some shit like that. I couldn't even go home half the time. And when I say home, I mean the shelter. I couldn't even go in the shelter half the time. Because the rules were, if you were not an adult, if you were not 18, you could not be left in the unit unsupervised by yourself. So if it was a situation where my sister's at work, because my sister was working at the time in the shelter, trying to get out, but my mom, I think my mom was like going to appointments and shit like that. So if my mom was out and my sister was out, I could not enter the fucking shelter. It was like 2-3 shelters that was like that. If there was no one adult in the unit, I could not enter. So you know how many days where it was raining, where it was snowing, where it's hot as shit, I'm thirsty, I'm hungry, my back hurting from this book bag, I got textbooks. Bro, I could not enter. I could not get in, bro. That has to be the lowest of the lowest feeling, bro. For you to know I don't have a crib, I have no apartment. I'm in the shelter. None of my real friends know because I'm too embarrassed to tell them. They going home, they chilling, they get to go in under the AC, relax, play video games, eat good, they moms is cooking. I can't even get into the fucking shelter. I have to wait for someone to get there. They might take hours, my nigga. And you know the feeling where, like, let's say you leave school, right? All my friends about to go do something, and I'm like, nah, I'm gonna go home. And I go home, and it's like, my nigga, I could have just fucking went with my friends. I could have killed time. Shit like that would happen all the time, bro. So now, I might be in Queens, or I might be in a shelter in the Bronx, but now I gotta walk around, or I gotta sit in front of a random building to just sit and wait, bro. Then when I do get in the crib or do get in the shelter, I gotta rush to do my homework and do it like it just wasn't it, bro. It just wasn't it for me. That's kind of shit a nigga was going through. But when I link up with my friends outside of school or outside of whatever, I'm smiling, laughing, yo, because I'm having such a good time because I'm away from my situation. To the point where my niggas don't even know what's going on for real. Don't even know my situation for real. You feel me? Niggas that wouldn't even understand it. I don't even know how to put it into words for niggas to understand it. Besides, I'm homeless. Niggas is not gonna feel my pain. They just gonna wanna laugh or talk shit. And I'm not saying my niggas for real, but when you a little kid, bro, you know how it is. It's like, niggas' mind ain't mature enough to understand what's going on. You know what I mean? When you're a little kid, niggas take everything as a joke, like, you know, so it was one of them things that I wasn't gonna let nobody really like embarrass me with, you feel me? 'Cause I might have to really hurt you. Like the joke, like your joke is my pain. You feel me? You know, so it was definitely a tough 6 years, bro. You know, ended up being a situation where I started graduating. I graduated and I still was in the shelter, bro. You know, the shelter hurt me because, you know, like you can't have company. You got curfew. Some of the joints, the curfew was 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. I'm gonna be honest, there were some shelters I went to that didn't have no curfew. And I'm gonna be honest, so I'm gonna explain something to y'all, right? So there was this thing that they would do sometimes where it was called a scatter site. Now listen, I'm really a shelter baby. Like anyone who's been in a shelter can vouch. So they would have some shit that's called a scatter site. Now, what a scatter site is, basically, that's when, because remember, you got to go to path, you got to talk to people, they got to figure out where they're going to place you, all of that. So a scatter site is basically like when you have a family that's eligible for like housing in a shelter, but they may not have enough shelters for you, like they may not have no spots for you in the shelter. So what they'll do is, if they know that there's a random building that has available, like that's vacant, an apartment that's vacant, they'll put you in that apartment. So it was like two occasions where was like two occasions where they put us in a scatter site. Where we was in a regular building with regular tenants, regular people that pay rent, but we was in one of their apartments and we was just living in there free. Just we was homeless though. But again, like you still had to report somewhere. You still had to go somewhere every week to go see a housing specialist. every other shelter, the housing specialist or like your case manager, they worked in the shelter. Like it was a separate part, a separate facility in the shelter, and you would go see them. You know what I'm saying? But now, if they put you in a scatter site, aka a regular apartment building, now you got to travel out your own way to go see your house person and go see a kid man. You know what I'm saying? So it was a couple times where they put us in a scatter site, and now when you're at the scatter site, it's a regular building, so you ain't got to worry about cameras and security and shit like that, signing in and out every day. So in them situations, now you can fake have company. Now you can fake beat the curfew, and you know what I mean? So the little 1-2 scatter sites that they put us in, that was where I had the most like freedom, and like I was staying out late with my friends and doing certain shit, you know, like. So that's what kind of helped my friends not catch on to what was going on between the years. Because it's like, there's no way this kid could be in a shelter if he was just with us the other day till 12 at night. Or he in the studio with us. Like, it was, you know, so it was those little moments that helped me, you know, trick my friends a little bit, if I should say. You know, but they didn't really know I was really going through it though, you know. But yeah, man, it definitely was a lot, you know. I remember I was in this one shelter, and see, this I feel like I could have made it a separate story time, because I'm kind of speeding ahead in life, but I'll tell you anyway. So the last shelter I was in, remember I said I got out when I was like 20. So the last shelter I was in, I remember I was like 20 years old. I was selling weed and shit like that, and I was selling weed at work for real, at Whole Foods. And this shelter was in Harlem. I forgot to mention I was in a shelter in Harlem. 55 West, 110th Street. And you know, this shelter, you know, same thing. You come in every day, you sign your name, had an elevator, you walk up the stairs if you want. And now this shelter was like the most unique one I've been in, because now the hallways were split up so crazy. Like the building was double-sided, and like, yo, each floor had to have at least like 40, like it was like 6 floors. Each floor had at least like 40 to 80 apartments, bro. Like, but the way they split it up, it's like the hallways was like in the shape of like a Y, then it would be like in the shape of a V. Like they cracked the, like it was so divided in so many ways that they was able to fit all these, you know what I mean? But now each apartment ain't a real apartment. Each apartment's actually just a fucking room, my nigga, with 2 beds in it and a fridge. That's all it was in it, and a window. So I'ma paint this picture for you niggas. This is why I'm built different. Picture you niggas in a room with your mom for 2 years. Your bed, her bed, and a fridge. Now, it wasn't like the beds were side by side, like fucking connecting and touching, but they definitely was like if I'm laying down, I could look at her, she's laying down, she's looking at me, like we probably was like 3 feet apart, like we was like a 10-year-old, like if a 10-year-old lay on the ground, that was the distance between her bed and my bed, my nigga. And we had a fridge and a window. Picture you living in a room like that with your mom for 2 years. Not to mention, each floor had like 4 bathrooms. But remember, each floor got like 40 units. So you basically had to share a bathroom. Like you, there's no way around it. Either you're sharing bathrooms. Not to mention, there's only like 4 kitchens. The kitchen only has a stove, nothing else. And I believe it was an electric, like the electric stove, like the metal shit that heat up. It wasn't even a fire stove. It had an electric stove, and I think it had an oven. You had to share a bathroom, you had to share a kitchen. My nigga, I never cooked food in that kitchen. I never made a meal in that kitchen. Nothing in that kitchen. For 2 years, I was eating outside food. The kitchen did not look like something you would want to make a meal in, bro. It wasn't even so much that it was dirty. It's just, this is not a real kitchen to me, bro. Well, I will give them credit at though. They had people that would come and clean the bathrooms every morning. Every morning. It don't matter if it was a holiday. Every morning, niggas would come and Lysol that bitch down. Windex, da-da-da-da-da, listed like Fabuloso, like they mopping the tub, all that. Like they got in it. Like that's one thing. The sink, all that. Like that's one thing I could say. But it's like, shit, you have to, my nigga. We in here with some dirty ass niggas. You feel me? So that's the only thing that gave you a little bit of comfort. Like, so now it's like niggas is waking up early. Like, we already know, like, all right, they about to clean by like 7:38. Bang. I'm about to go doodle at like 8:30, boy. Cause like I'm not about to go wait till like 4 to go try to doodle my my nigga. Like, we gonna be the first one on that toilet. You hear me? Like, that's how we moving. Like real rap. Pause, you feel me? Like, so it's just like shit was crazy, bro. Shit was buck wild, you feel me? But I remember around the time I was selling weed, I had to explain how the spot looked. So I remember around the time I was selling weed and shit, making a killing at work. I'm making like 300 a day at work. Going crazy. Yeah, I'm 250 on a bad day. On a bad day, my nigga. On a good day, I make it like 4, 5, 6. Like, making a killing. To the point now, I'm making a killing in the shelter too. My mom don't know I'm doing this. She don't know I'm selling weed. She don't know I'm none of that. I'm hiding it real well. I'm in this one room with my mom all year round, but I'm hiding it so well, like. Feel me? I think she came across it one time. I don't know, but I'm hiding this so well though. At this point, she been found out that I did it before, you feel me? But at this point, I'm hiding it well though. Like, now I'm selling even to niggas in the building though. Security guards, people that live there. I got the most fire bud in the building. Like, niggas know that. And this go to show you, like, my heart though. Like, or like, you mean? The type of timing I was on. I got the most fire bud at my job. That's why I'm making so much at work. And I worked at Whole Foods. I didn't work at no little ass fact. No, I worked at Whole Foods. Whole Foods is a big ass company, gang. That's like working at Amazon or some shit. So if you killing at Whole Foods, you killing at Amazon, you know you got that pain. You know, like, damn, if mad niggas is coming to you every day, you know you got that pain. Cause all these niggas live in different neighborhoods and all type of shit. So if they saving their money to come to you, you know you got that pain. Like, that's what I'm trying to tell y'all. Like, I had that pain. You feel me? So even at the shelter, I'm selling the niggas and shit, niggas in the building, I got that pain, blood niggas, all types of shit. Like, I'm in there smoking with them. Like, it's to the point, like, looking back in retrospect, and I knew this at the time, niggas could have fake packed me up if they wanted to. Like, I'm putting myself in situations where I'm in the room with like three blood niggas and I'm in there playing video games with them. Like, niggas could have fake packed me up, but I was always so smart that I wouldn't come in there with extra butt on me, none of that. It was always a, oh, you need some? Let me go downstairs and go get it. I would never come in there with extra, none of that. I'm from Brownsville, my nigga. Are you dumb? You feel me? So I always was sturdy too, like, and they knew that. You feel me? And some of them was trying to fake turn me under. Nah, I'm good. I'm sturdy, you feel me? They wasn't even that they tried to turn me under, but they would say certain shit like, yo, what up, blood? Or like, they'll try to peach me, like, nah, you know what I mean? I give you a regular handshake, gang. You feel me? Like, you know, but shit like that. So now I remember this one time, right? And now looking back in the retrospect, I don't. Wow. Now that I'm telling the story time, yeah, niggas probably try to set me. I don't know, like, but I remember this one time. So at the time, I think I was like on the third floor, the second floor. I can't remember. I think I was on the second floor. But we had a fire escape all throughout the building. Remember, it's a big ass building. So one day, I come up, and it's like anytime, like, so when you come on the floor, There was a door she had to open to get to your floor. Anytime you open this door, it was a loud, distinctive door. So like, niggas could tell someone just came on the floor. And typically, again, like I had a job, so I typically would come home around the same time. So if a nigga heard this door open at like fucking 9:15, niggas typically knew it was me. So I remember one time the door opens, and this girl who always used to cop me, like, yo, like, what's up? Like, she opened her door, came trying to cop me. Boom, I go in the kitchen, I bring her to the kitchen, because remember, we still in the shelter though. It's still security guards, they be roaming around. They gotta make sure everybody's safe at the same time. They got walkie talkies and shit. So I bring her to the kitchen, we slide to the kitchen, I sell her like a dub or some shit at the time. A dime, I don't even remember. Sell her some shit. Now I see some nigga in the hallway though. Never seen this nigga in my life. I sell the shit to her. Mind you, my apartment or my unit, my room or whatever, was literally right next door to the kitchen. So all I gotta do is leave this kitchen and go next door. She fake gotta do some walking. She gotta walk down the hall. This nigga is like three doors down from, like he's standing with his foot on the wall, leaning back against the wall. He's like three doors down from my apartment. The nigga go, hey yo, shorty, I know you're not selling in my building. I'ma keep it a bean with you niggas. I didn't say a word. I didn't respond. Because now I'm kind of caught off guard, like, wait, like, is he talking to me? Like, I'm confused. Like, everybody already know I do my thing in here. So I've never seen you, nigga. So I'm confused. This is what I'm saying to myself in my head. So I ain't seen her. Nigga, I zip my, mind you, I got mad work on me. So at the same time, I'm trying to be smart. Like, let me zip up this work. Let me make sure, like, let me put this book back on my back. But like, this is what I'm worried about. So now I come out the kitchen. I stand there. And he's like, yeah, this is my building. Like, I don't know what you want, but you better not be busting no sales in here. Da, 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 da. So now the girl that I be busting sales with, because she's really not a girl. She's really an old ass lady. She's probably like, at the time, she probably was like 35. You feel me? So she thought, hey, leave him alone. Like, da, 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 da. Like, why are you worried about him? And like, he fine. Like, leave him alone. Like, da, da, da. He mad young. Like, leave him alone. Like, she fake protecting me, like, she, you feel me? But like, he like, man, I don't give a fuck. Like, So now I look at the nigga. I take my keys out, put it in my door. I go in my apartment like a little bitch. But it wasn't that I was running. This is what y'all gotta understand. Whenever you get in the shelter, they explain to you, and I've seen it happen to other people. They say, yo, if you come in here and you fight, we putting you out. And you're gonna have to go right back to PATH. That's the headquarters where everybody online. You're coming in with your tool bags. You gotta go through the metal detector, go through all it, get back on the cheese. But like, I'm not doing all of that, bro. I'm not jeopardizing me and mama. We're already down bad in this situation. I'm not fighting no nigga. Win, lose, or draw, we get kicked out, and for what? You feel me? So I'm fake again, so it's not even so much that I'm scared of him, it's I'm scared of what's gonna happen. So I ignore him, like, I get back to my apartment. Mind you, the walls are so thin, you can hear a conversation from damn near downstairs. So now it's like, my mom is in here, like, she probably heard this nigga, you know what I'm saying? I'm in the apartment. I'm unwinding down. I'm dressing myself, putting my basketball shorts. I'm on my phone. I'm not worried about this nigga. I just made my little sale. I'm about to keep it pushing. I'm about to call it a night. Not to mention, I forgot to mention this part too. I'm really not scared of him because I lived on the left side of the kitchen. On the right side of the kitchen, me and my mom was cool with this little family that was on the other side of the kitchen. It was an old lady, she was like a grandma, and her grandson. The grandson was some big, tall nigga. This nigga was claiming Crip. And he was like that. He had a gun and all that. I've seen the gun. He was mad cool with me. He used to buy buds for me and all that. So I really wasn't scared of this nigga because I knew worst come to worst, I could call my son right here if I needed a little protection. You feel me? Because now keep in mind, I'm like 19. The nigga that was popping shit outside, the nigga look like he like 28. So it's like, I'm not afraid of him, but I'm not naive to know that like he might be more advanced than me. And I might have to call my homie who was more advanced, because the Crip nigga I'm talking about looked like he like 30, 28, or 26. You know what I mean? So it's like, yeah, you know, but I'm a man though. I'm gonna do whatever I gotta do. Remember, I ignored this nigga. Why, like 10 minutes later, I hear a knocking on my door. My mom hear the knocking. So I get up like, hold on, hold the fuck up. I'm like, hold on, hold the fuck up. I go, I crack the door, because there was no doorbell, no peephole. I crack the door, I see it's the same nigga that was just popping it. So now I'm like, he like, yo, come outside. Like, I'm gonna talk to you real quick. I'm like, for what? He like, nah, my fault, but I really like this. Come outside, I'm gonna talk to you. So now I'm fake hot now. Like I'm like, all right, bet. Now I fake close the door. Now I'm like, give me a minute. Close the door. Now I'm putting on my kicks. Now I'm hot. Remember, I'm in my tank top. I'm on my shorts. And now I put on my kicks. Now I'm hot. Because it's like, yo, bro. And let me, I'm gonna break down why I'm hot. Like that all that fear that I had just went out the window. And I'm gonna tell y'all why. First of all, I'm already down bad in this situation. I already don't even want to be in this situation. I'm trapped and doing what I gotta do to make my little bread. You damn near just fucked up a cell I just had. You talking crazy and I let you rock. Now you knocking on my door. And it's like, yo, bro, if me and my mom live here, again, remember I said I'm Haitian, bro, with that oppression shit and all, like, I don't tolerate none of that. Like, so one, like, you know where me and my mom stay. You not about to ever feel like you could knock on this door again. Like, what make you think you could just knock on my door again? Like, that's what it was like. Nah, now you're wildin'. You feel me? So boom, I put on my kicks. Boom, I go down. I open the door. I don't see boy. Boy down the hall. I go walk down the hall. I go see boy. He by the window. So now when I see him by the window, nigga talk like he leaned back. I'm standing. I'm ready. He like, yo, what's up? Now, I kid you not, right hand to God, the nigga is trying to see one of my dumb. So I'm like, he like, let me see when you're done. Like, I go front, like, shorty told me your shit fire. You been with your little thing for a minute. Like, I ain't know that. Like, you feel me? I'm like, yeah, I've been doing my thing for a little minute. You feel me? I just fuck with who I fuck with. Like, you feel me? But mind you, whole time, like, eye contact on 100. My back stands straight, firm. Like, no, like, you feel me? He's in that laid back, relaxed, like, feel me? Like, he telling me he drunk for real. Like, yeah, I was drinking, like, my four, like, ooh, like, he like, yeah, nah, but let me see one of them. I'm like, nah, like, I'm like, you about to buy it? Like, feel me? I got doms, I got dubs, feel me? Like, I got my own shit though, so why would I have to buy it? I'm like, all right, that's cool. So you could, feel me? You Gucci with your shit then, but I don't do no trading, no, feel me? I don't do that, like, feel me? So the nigga, like, mind you, now the nigga shorty pulling up. Now the nigga shorty, I recognize the shorty though. I've seen her in the building. You feel what I'm saying? So she like, oh, it's him. Like, you argue with him? Like, nah, I see it. So now she telling him like I'm good money, but like I don't even know his girl like that either though. You feel me? So what I later found out was because the girl that I bust the sale to, that I sold the dime to, that was like, leave him alone. She told me the next day, he don't even live in the building. The nigga be climbing up the fire escape and shit, sneaking in the building because his shorty live in the building. The shorty live in the shelter, so he just be sneaking in. Da-da-da-da. So it's like, what? A nigga try to press me and try to say this his shit and you don't even live in here, my nigga? Like, You feel me? But long story short, it ain't go nowhere. I dubbed him. I didn't give him nothing. You feel me? Like, I told him, like, nah, like, you're not really popping it. Like, I can't really, nothing I can do for you. Like, feel me? It was really short that I walked off. Gangsta, like, feel me? I was really with all the smoke at that point. Because, again, like, you want to pop your shit? I'm going to let you have it. I'm going to give you that pass. But don't ever in your life, bro, like, don't put your hands on me. And don't think you could bring harm or danger to where me and my people stay. Like, don't ever in your life, bro. Like, you feel me? So, that was that. And trust me, as I was talking to him, he felt my, like, assertiveness. Like, he know, like, don't, like, come on, gang. I'm willing to take it there with you. You feel me? But, you know, that was that situation. I ain't never see him after that. I still was doing my thing, you feel me? And I ended up getting caught selling weed at my job because it was situated. It's a long story. I don't even want to get into it, but some little joint ended up stealing weed out of my book bag. But she was a store thief. She was stealing money out of people's book bag. She was caught on camera. She was caught. They asked her, what was she taking? Da, da, da. She told them she was taking my weed and this, that, and the third, taking this, that. So they're like, what? Weed? Bitch, ratted on me, gang. Ratted on my whole process, my whole organization, all that. Like, packed me up from Whole Foods. My dog making bread, 600 a day. I'm in the shelter making bread, bro. So now she just fucked up my whole shit. So now I had to call my big brother. My big brother put me on to American Eagle. Started working at American Eagle. You know what I'm saying? I did that for like a year. Still in the shelter. And while I was working at American Eagle, I started working at Planet Fitness on top of that. And then while I had the funds, while I was in the shelter, my mom ended up having a stroke. You know? And, I forgot to mention a couple things. My sister ended up separating herself from our case in the shelter. So she ended up getting her own shelter case. And me and my mom were still together. You know, reason being is because my sister ended up finding a boyfriend throughout the years. He was messing around. His living situation wasn't the greatest, so they decided to go into the shelter together. You know, so she kind of left us hanging. But, you know, it definitely worked out for the better. You know, at the time, we was very bitter about it. But it did work out for the better because she ended up getting her own apartment with that nigga. They're not together no more, but she ended up getting her own crib. And then now me and my mom was able to move out and get our own spot. So it's like, it would have been bad if we all were still living together, still mad grown now, you know? So the fact that we was able to separate and break off and have two different locations now, you know, it made it better for everybody, you know? So that was a diamond in the rough, you know, a diamond in the dirt type situation, you know? I ended up, so God worked, remember we was homeless for 6 years. My sister got her crib February 4th, 2016. And we landed our apartment February 11th, 2016. So literally 7 days after, literally a week after. That was powerful, bro. Cause you gotta think like, for us to be homeless for 6 years, trying. And then 1 week, one day you just hear, yo. You just hear your sister say, yo, she got her apartment. Like, we kind of was a little like, damn, that's fine, you feel me? Hopefully, you know what I mean? But I knew I was in the works of working on my shit. Week later, we was able to solidify it. And then we had our shit. You know, my mom had a stroke at around that time, you know, so I really was in the shelter by myself, doing it on my own, working, saving, doing this, looking for apartments, running around, you know, and I ended up managing to steal the deal on one in the Bronx. That's where I've been ever since, you know. And my mom ended up coming out the hospital, you know, and I've been her caretaker, and I've been providing, you know, making it through ever since, you know. But this is just a story about how, you know, being evicted as a kid. You know, a lot of people never experienced that. They don't really know what it's like, the emotions, the trauma. You know, I feel like it's still things I suffer from, like, to this day from that, you know? It make you very antisocial, trust issues, you know? Your interest in a lot of shit dwindles down. Like, you don't care for a lot of shit, but a lot of shit that you probably shouldn't care for, you do. You know, it's tough, you know? Therapy is definitely recommended for people that go through that, you know, but I feel like me even doing these right now is a little bit of therapy, you know, smoke a lot of weed. I've always been a deep thinker, you know, so I be in my mind a lot, I be in my thoughts a lot, but I do music, you know, so I've been, you know, and I've always found ways to just release my emotions, you know. It don't even got to be releasing anger, but release the emotions, you feel me, because everything ain't anger, you feel me. Sometimes it's pain, sometimes it's hope, sometimes it's regret, sometimes it's misinformation, you know, different types of feelings. I just take it day by day and I just go on and live with it as it is, you know. I was kind of trying to make the story time a certain type of way. I don't really know how it's gonna translate, you know, on the listen back, but I feel like I said everything I needed to say that was powerful for real. Yeah, it's just this is an important story to me. It's an important episode to me, because like I said, a lot of things still, you know, affect my life to this day, you know. And I think about people all the time that's still in them situations. What they going through, how worse it's been since then, you know, how more strict the rules gotten, and you know, I know a lot of people going through it, you know. I be seeing a couple of the security guards that used to work in some of these shelters, and you know, they see me now, it's like I lost weight, you know, I got my own crib and I could drive now, so it's just like crazy, you know, and life sometimes you just gotta wait your turn. I always knew that, you know, but 6 years was a dark, long 6 years, man. You know, so, one thing that, you know, I'm gonna say that for the next story time. Listen, man, it's been good for all of y'all out there. It's a long one for y'all, man. I wouldn't change. Shit about to take me 3 weeks to upload this to YouTube, man. But man, I appreciate y'all rocking out, sticking this. Boy, bless you, man. Stay tuned for part 4, man. Eat it.